Welcome to another capsule on international relations for the Shankar IAS Academy. Today we discuss the Shanghai Cooperation Organization, which held a meeting on the 17th of September, partly in Dushanbe and partly online. The SCO of the Shanghai Cooperation Organization was set up in June 2001 in Shanghai by the leaders of China, Kazakhstan, Kyrgyzstan, Russia, Tajikistan, and Uzbekistan. You can see that all of them, apart from China, were all republics of the former Soviet Union. So this was an initiative by China to keep a friendly attitude towards the former republics of the Soviet Union, and Russia also joined. Subsequently, India and Pakistan joined in 2017, and Iran in 2021, that is this year, for this conference. So what began as a group of former republics of the Soviet and China became a larger group and a diverse group when India and Pakistan and Iran joined. But as it happened, the particular group now looks like all the neighboring countries of Afghanistan, which is very much in the news. So even though this meeting was just an annual meeting of the SCO, it assumed a certain importance because this was the first time that a group of neighboring countries of Afghanistan were meeting after the takeover of Afghanistan by the Taliban. In fact, I spoke to you the other day about BRICS. The BRICS also, with Brazil, Russia, India, China, and South Africa, also had interest in Afghanistan. And there were some statements in BRICS which created an atmosphere of consensus among those countries. So here again, the meeting basically focused on Afghanistan. These annual meetings of the SCO normally discusses all political issues and also hold exercises, military exercises together in order to ensure certain security. Of course, the contradiction is that both India and Pakistan are there, and therefore these exercises are held separately, never India and Pakistan joining in. But more importantly, this has become now, in the context of Afghanistan, a group of countries who are all interested in Afghanistan. China has assumed the leader of this group right from the beginning. And even earlier, soon after the withdrawal of the US troops from Afghanistan, some meetings were held at the ministerial level where our external affairs minister also participated. The Prime Minister of India addressed the SCO meeting from Delhi, while our External Affairs Minister traveled to Dushanbe, where some of the meetings were held, and he was also able to meet the Foreign Minister of China. So these days of the pandemic, the opportunities for bilateral meetings are very few, and most of these were taking place online. But now, because of a slight change in the situation, the pandemic situation, more meetings are being held in person. Like the next meeting of the Quad is going to be in Washington in person. So this was an intermediate stage where it was held partly online and partly in offline. So apart from the Prime Minister addressing the session, The foreign minister or external affairs minister was also there, and he had the chance to talk to his counterparts in so this was probably the first time that the prime minister was addressing the question of Afghanistan in a public forum. Therefore, he spoke extensively on the situation in Afghanistan. Though the group is composed of countries which have different shades of opinion on Afghanistan, from the statements, one could see that there was a certain agreement on some fundamental issues. All the countries were, of course, not on the same page on their approach to Taliban, but all of them had a major stake in the future of Afghanistan. The fact that Taliban returned to power after a US war on terror, which lasted 20 years, it was a shock to all of them. Of course, Pakistan, China, and Russia were supportive of the new dispensation in Afghanistan, but others had several conditions for recognizing the new government. They were also concerned about the re-emergence of terrorism in Afghanistan and the possibility of an economic collapse necessitating massive humanitarian assistance. So the indications from the Taliban that they would follow the same fundamentalist and medieval policies based on Sharia law was a matter of concern for all of them, except, of course, Pakistan. So there was a convergence of opinion, and the differences were not so obvious. So immediate concern now is not the withdrawal of US troops and the chaos that followed, but how to deal with this new government. The issue of recognition was, of course, very much there. Pakistan, China, and Iran already maintained their missions in Kabul, but they have not done any recognition. But others are still waiting, even the neighboring countries. And therefore, fundamentally, there are differences within the group. But on the whole, SEO provided an opportunity for them to identify various areas in which there was convergence. Prime Minister Narendra Modi was very frank and open about the situation in Afghanistan. He said that the political change in Afghanistan did not lead to an inclusive system, and the process was not conducted through negotiation. He also said that the neighbors of Afghanistan would be seriously impacted by the developments in that country. He said, the first issue, I'm quoting, the first issue is that the change of authority in Afghanistan was not intrusive, and this happened without negotiation. This raises questions on the prospects of recognition of the new system. Representation of all sections of Afghans, including women and the minorities, is important. And that is why it is necessary that the global community should think carefully and collectively while deciding on the legitimacy of the new political system in Afghanistan, unquote. So he expressed India's support for the central role of the United Nations in the deliberation regarding the current system in Afghanistan. So it was very clear that India had several conditions before it is possible for India to think of recognition. As we have discussed earlier, the whole policy of India is now a wait and see policy on Afghanistan. The Pakistan Prime Minister, of course, who considers to have won this war, because at the end of the war, it was Pakistan which directed the operations in Panjshir, and the ISI chief was in Kabul when the composition of the new Taliban government was announced. So the first point that Imran Khan was made was that Afghanistan could not be controlled from the outside. What he means is United States or India, and that Islamabad will continue to support the war-torn neighboring country, even as he heard the Taliban to fulfill the promises they have made. So at least for the form's sake of form, he had to say that they have to fulfill their promises. He highlighted the need to mobilize international support for an immediate humanitarian assistance in Afghanistan, which is now ruled by the Taliban. And here again, I'm quoting Imran Khan. He said, "We must remember that the Afghan government is primarily dependent on foreign aid. The Taliban must fulfill the promises they have made. Pakistan has a vital interest in peaceful and stable Afghanistan and will continue to lend its support." He spoke as the winner in Afghanistan, having helped the Taliban during the war with the US and shaped the new government, with the Pakistan spy network having key positions in the Taliban government, as we discussed earlier. The interior minister is the head of the Haqqani network, which is nothing but an agency of the Pakistani intelligence. Of course, the Chinese statement was also very interesting. China's president, Xi Jinping, who also spoke online, called on the Taliban government to adopt prudent and moderate policies, not a very severe criticism, and said its neighbor should encourage Kabul to do so. So he put the onus on the neighbors to make sure that Taliban is able to follow a moderate and prudent policy. In other words, the neighbors should not provoke Taliban into doing anything else. And Beijing has stepped up its diplomacy with countries in the region, including Russia, Pakistan, and Iran. He urged the members of the President of China, urged the members of the SCO to encourage Afghanistan to put in place a broad-based and inclusive political framework, adopt prudent and moderate domestic policies and foreign policy, resolutely fight all forms of terrorism, live in amity with its neighbors, and truly embark on a path of peace, stability, and development. So it was a very sympathetic statement. He said the country faced many daunting challenges, and it needs the support and assistance of the international community, as he called on SCO members to step up coordination, make full use of the platforms such as the SCO Afghanistan contact group, and facilitate a smooth transition. So China's happiness over the recent events was very clear in his statement. But something more significant has happened in Dushanbe as far as Chinese foreign policy is concerned. He called a separate meeting, what he called an informal meeting, with Russia, Pakistan, and Iran. So assuming that these are the four countries who are going to work with Taliban, he held a meeting. And Mr. Wang Yi, he said, the four countries had a role to play as important neighbors of Afghanistan and influential countries in the region. So within SCO itself, he made a categorization. Thus, these four countries are important neighbors and influential in the region, while others like India and the Central Asian republics would not have such a necessary role. It is necessary for us, four countries, strengthen communication and coordination, make unanimous voices, exert positive influence, and play a constructive role in the smooth transition of the situation in Afghanistan. So they are taken on the responsibility, China, Russia, Pakistan, and Iran. And then he outlined a 5-point proposal for the four countries to follow, including urging the US to learn lessons from the past, working to tackle spillover security risks, and getting the new Taliban regime to make a clean break with terrorist forces, and providing assistance to the war-torn country. Then he said, regional countries have three main expectations for the new Afghan government: inclusiveness, counter-terrorism, and good neighborliness. Adding that China is ready to step up coordination with Russia, Pakistan, Iran, and the other countries in the region to play a constructive role in preventing chaos, maintaining stability, combating terrorism and violence, realizing peace and reconstruction of Afghanistan, and ultimately achieving lasting peace in the region. So this is a very significant statement and a significant position that China has taken. So briefly, what happened was that certain basic points, there was convergence. For example, one point that everybody made was that Taliban must have a break with terrorism. But that is something which even China or Pakistan cannot endorse, even though they may indirectly support terrorist activities on the, or will not insist that they should give up terrorism altogether. It is difficult for them. They are, some of them are United Nations recognized terrorists who are in the cabinet. But at least verbally, they all talked about elimination of terrorism. They all talked about inclusiveness of the new government. And they all talked about the need for the international community to support Afghanistan, because a very huge humanitarian crisis is looming large in Afghanistan. And as you know, there has been a pledging conference of the United Nations, and many countries pledge support, regardless of the situation, regardless of the recognition. But at the same time, the Secretary General is in a dilemma. Because what does he do with this money? Who does he give it to? He cannot give it to Taliban. So it has to find agencies, normally formally NGOs, humanitarian organizations, to go into Afghanistan, and their security has to be guaranteed. So though there is money available with the United Nations being pledged by many countries, even including India, dispensation of this humanitarian assistance is a problem. And so the SCO underlined this, that whether we like this government or not, whether we recognize the government or not, it is necessary to have humanitarian assistance for the country. But the very significant difference in this case was that Pakistan, China, and Iran are much more supportive of the Taliban. Theirs are not conditionalities. Theirs are only requests to Taliban. While in the case of India, it's a very specific demand. And we have said clearly that, you know, a decision on recognition can be taken by the international community only after we see change in Taliban's attitude, and also assurance that the government will be, the cabinet will be expanded, and they will include other elements. But the situation in Kabul has deteriorated. In fact, today there was a bombing by ISK, which had a bigger bombing earlier, killed about 180 people, including some 19 or 20 US soldiers. But today there was a smaller bomb explosion outside the airport, killing some half a dozen people. And there are reports that women are still being harassed. The new policy has been declared that women need not go to work for the time being, and they need not go to the colleges, etc. also. So there is no change at all, you can see, in the Taliban government's attitude. And this makes it even more difficult for other countries to come to terms and to provide assistance. So now the whole situation is moving to the United Nations. General Assembly will start soon, and also the Quad will have a meeting face to face. And our Prime Minister is having a bilateral meeting with President Biden. And so this week, 24th, 25th, etc., will be very significant. In fact, the Prime Minister of India will also be addressing in the General Assembly on the 25th, after having had a meeting with President Biden. So this is a very significant week where we have to keep a watch on what happens in the United Nations and also what happens on the ground. The reports from the ground are not at all good, and therefore considerable concern. But what can the United Nations do is a big question mark. They can engage in humanitarian assistance, but there is no way the United Nations Security Council can take any action, either for or against the Taliban. So the SCO meet was helpful in identifying some common elements in which all of them could agree. But the division was also very sharp. And so SCO as an organization will not be able to do much, just as BRICS as an organization could not do much in the context of Afghanistan. But I was just thinking, if there was no Afghanistan crisis, what SCO would have done? They would have generally talked about other issues, etc. So now there is a question of the utility of these groupings, because there are so many groupings of so many countries, same in other group. And you also heard about the AUKUS, the new group or alliance which have been formed between United States, UK, and Australia, which has created considerable commotion in Western countries, particularly France. So when you already have a Quad, why do you go and create another alliance? This may be because India and Japan have not been so committed as an alliance for their own foreign policy objectives. And therefore, United States felt that they need a pure military alliance in the Indo-Pacific region. And so they picked UK and Australia and made a group called AUKUS, AUKUS, Australia, UK, US. And France is very upset about it, because one of the purposes of AUKUS is to give Australia the technology from the United States for nuclear-propelled submarines. Not nuclear submarines. Nuclear submarines means submarines with nuclear weapons inside it. That technology, United States does not give to anybody. Even on nuclear-propelled submarines, it has been transferred only to the UK. So the specific purpose of this new group is being explained that this is to enable Australia to build nuclear-propelled submarines in a big way, because their relations with China has deteriorated and the threat in the Indian Ocean region is becoming dangerous. So Australia, which was quite friendly to China, has changed its position and formed this. But the problem with France is something different. France has a very strong connection with Australia for manufacturing usual diesel electric submarines, a huge project, billions of dollars. And this AUKUS arrangement will in fact endanger that, because Australia will now be moving on to nuclear propelled submarines. So France has recalled its ambassadors from UK and USA, making very strong statements. And even the Quad countries like us are also concerned as to what this is. Why is it that they're creating more groups? So a stage has come when people will look at all these various groups and what some of these groups are set up for specific purposes, and they become redundant and still they continue. So if you look at these many groups operating, you will find that there is so much of duplication, there is so much of differences, they are not united entirely, and whether it is worthwhile having these groups which do not have a common cause to fight for. So these questions have arisen as a result of these two meetings, BRICS and SCO, as well as the emergence of AUKUS. We will deal with Quad and AUKUS, etc. in the next week, because there will be further developments in this regard. Thank you very much.